pray with me this morning? Father, thank you for these brothers and sisters who come and help lead us in worship. Father, I thank you for the people who make the coffee and sweep the floors and just do all the myriad of things that need to be done, from making slides to making copies. Father, we thank you for them. I thank you for the people that you bring, whether it's right here in the room or online. God, we just thank you that that your word moves through us and on, and it never comes back void. Father, most of all, we just thank you for you. And we pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Well, I don't know about your family. My family's a little tired this morning. My wife took my teenage sons, or maybe I should say my teenage sons took my wife to mother-daughter dance. And yeah, I heard they danced, which is interesting. One of my sons, I'm certain, did not dance. If there's video, I'll believe it. We'll see. What do you think, Dan? Did you dance? No, he's like, no, I don't want to talk about it. And so then I took my three youngest girls to see some horrible movie. What was it, Beauty and the Beast? Sometimes when my wife and I go to the movies, we'll see like lines and lines of people all lined up for something. I'm like, who would do that? That's crazy. You know, you line up all night long so you could watch some movie. So last night we got there and they're like, there's the line for the movie you want to see. It's like 2 hours long. Yeah, that was fun. So I was that person. And then we paid the 80 bucks or whatever it is to see a movie. And then one of my daughters slept through it. No, it's true. She slept through it. So anyway, I'm trying to get my money back today. Anyway, welcome. We've been going through a series, and today we're going to end it if the people in the room can remember the verse that I've been trying to teach them. So you have to remember like the definition of stewardship, and then you have to remember the verse. And if you can't, I'm going to preach on for another 25 weeks. What do you think? All right, we'll give it a try. Oh, so the stewardship series has nothing really to do with money. We're just talking about things we need to manage in our lives. So that's a hint for you. And the definition we're using of stewardship, before it comes up on the screen, is carefully and... I'll give that like a 71. Okay, put it on the screen. It's carefully and responsibly managing something entrusted to one's care. And so you might say, well, I don't have anything careful to care about, or I don't have anything expensive to care about. That's not true. You got you. You got life. You got lungs, right? You got breath. And you probably have a few resources that God has given you, whether it's money or a house or, you know, whatever. Maybe you can sing. Maybe you know how to serve in some other way. God is saying, I'm going to count for that one day. I'm going to expect a return on my investment. I've given you something, and I'm going to ask you how you did. And what we're hoping to hear is, well done, good and faithful servant. But some of us, unfortunately, hopefully no one in this room or anyone who hears me preach, because that would make me just internally sad, is depart from me, I never knew you. I'm introducing a new series this week right after the stewardship one, and it's called Hi, I'm Jesus. And so you got it in your bulletin. Why would I say, Hi, I'm Jesus? You know, it seems a little silly, right? Well, there's a verse in Matthew that basically says this. Many will say to me on that day, Lord, Lord, did I not prophesy in your name, and your name cast out demons and perform many miracles? And I will look at them plainly and say, I never knew you. And so it's a haunting verse, but it's also the words of Christ. And so if you look at it, he's saying to people that are in the church, they're saying, I performed miracles, I did things for you, I did all this stuff for you. And he's saying, yeah, but I never knew you. So hopefully that will prompt you to want to get excited about actually making sure that you know Jesus and that he knows you. Because every other pursuit of your life, friends, is an absolute waste of time if that isn't happening. Anyway, so that's next week. This week we're going to wind up the stewardship service and series, and we're going to do it with remembering Psalm 24:1. You guys know it, right? Don't put it up, Lindsay. Psalm 24:1, I'll get you started. The earth is the Lord, and all it, and, oh my God, we could do better down in the preschool. All right, we're going to start over. Put it on the screen. The earth is the Lord's and all it contains, the world and all those who dwell in it, for he has established it upon, or founded it upon the seas and established it upon the rivers. Amen? Amen. So everything belongs to who?
Lord.
The Lord. And so what he's saying is, you may be a steward, but I'm your co-steward. I'm not leaving you alone. I'm giving you things to manage, things to steward. And it's the same word, but I'm helping you do it if you lean on me, if you look to me. Okay? All right. So maybe after today, we can get rid of this series. So my mother used to say to me, maybe she said to some of you, Jimmy, you're wasting your life. I think it started maybe around 12. By 13, I was already hooked on at least a pack a day of cigarettes. And my mom and my stepdads all smoked, so I would just snag a pack here and there. I was cool at school because I always had a pack of Winstons. They really wanted Marlboros, but they didn't smoke Marlboros, so I couldn't get those. But I was already addicted to them. I was already smoking other stuff, you know, by 13, 14 years old. At 15, I made my first son. Fortunately, God works things out, and he led worship for us this morning. But it wasn't a good road. In fact, I was wasting my life. Anybody else there? Well, here's the thing. I mean, my grandparents were Christians, at least as far as I know. I think one of them maybe wasn't, my paternal grandfather, but all the rest were. And my mother was raised in the church, and my father was taken to the church. But at some point, they said, it's the 60s. We don't really want to do that anymore. It was really probably the 50s, but then I was born in 1961. After they eloped to Mexico, you know, here I come. My grandmother, I know, certainly my paternal grandmother, my father's mother, took me to church a few times, and I believe they all loved the Lord. But here's what happened. I didn't have a whole lot of Bible in my life once they all, my parents, decided to divorce, and my mother was married a couple more times. We moved off, and we never went to church. We just didn't have anything in our lives, really, that kind of, I mean, I knew there was a God, but I didn't really care. And so I took on all the myths of the world around me, right? Probably just like the ones you hear. And so I believed all kinds of crazy stuff. I believed that if I was a good person, that God wouldn't hurt me or hate me. I used to pray all the time. I knew he was a God, so I'd be like, God, if I've done anything bad, don't put me in hell, okay? And I was like, okay, now I'm good to that minute. Now if I don't screw up for the next, you know, however long. It's kind of a Catholic theology, kind of. But I believed that. If I was a good person, everything was okay. I believed a lot of God stuff, but I also believed a lot about evolution and about controlling things. And I just kind of wanted to live my life. Anybody else? And so anyway, you know, when I was short of 16, my mother put me out on the street. She couldn't handle me anymore. She sent me to live with a stepfather. Eventually, I was couch surfing. A lot of debauchery. I dropped out of high school, got a construction job, you know, made a lot of turmoil in a lot of lives of young people. Of course, there's the alcohol thing. I mean, that was never really leading to anything good. I spent a few nights in jail here and there because I just couldn't get it together, right? I mean, I would just do the dumbest stuff. Fortunately, back then, the U.S. Air Force didn't have good standards. And so I went in, and I don't know why, I just knew I had to get out of this construction thing. It was just horrible, you know, Dallas, Texas, the sun of the day, the cold, and whatever. And so I went into the recruiter, and I took a test. Must have been a miracle. I got, like, a perfect score. I mean, here I'm in high school dropout. I got Fs and everything. I never cared about anything, and I got a perfect score. And they're like, whoa, hey, you know, we got one on the line, right? And so before they knew that I was a fatherless kid and been in all kinds of trouble and had been in jail a little bit here and there, they already kind of had me, you know, kind of marked. And I think this guy, I believe it's an act of God, but this recruiter just kind of took me under his wing. He helped me get some waivers, you know, that you have to get if you've been in any trouble. And what do you know? I'm off into the military. And it went pretty well until I got 4 DUIs. 4. Back then they called them DWIs, but I got 4 of them. Yeah, I mean, I was just stupid. But they were stupid too, because they sent me to Germany and said, hey, be good. Right? I mean, they don't even have good water over there. What are you going to drink, right? And I was a good worker, don't get me wrong. But after work, hey, let's go, right? And then I got a second job at the club. That wasn't good, because you got to get home from the club, right? It's the truth. So they put me up for court-martial like 3 times, and I just accepted the punishment. Seriously, 3 times. And not all for drinking, mostly for fighting, just getting stupid, couldn't make it to work. That's my life. Not a good steward. I was not a good steward. I was just a good steward of what I wanted to do. But eventually, through the grace of God and an act of God, I get into a carpool, which you've heard me tell many times is my only testimony. I get into a carpool because I'm an aide to a general in the Pentagon and then an executive officer eventually to a general in the Pentagon. And I had to be there at like 5:50 a.m. And so you can't park at the Pentagon. There's just, especially if you know you don't have the high rank. And so you have to get in a carpool. And so by act of God or grace or whatever you want to call it, I put my name and my number in. I say I need to be at the Pentagon before 6 a.m. and I can go home at whatever time. And they say, all right, these people will pick you up tomorrow morning. What's your address? And they picked me up. And on the way to the Pentagon from my house where I was living with some girl, they listened to Jim Dobson on the phone or on the radio. Who's ever heard of Jim Dobson? Dr. Jim Dobson. Yeah. I mean, I was like, who is this guy, right? And he's talking about all kind of Bible stuff. I'm like, oh, man, I got myself in trouble now. Right? I like to listen to rock and roll on my way to work. But I'm in my 20s. Believe it or not, when you're married and divorced, which I was then, had a couple children doing the whole thing, believe me, it kept me from being ordained for a really long time because, my life didn't start out well. I'm doing the things that a lot of people are doing, blended family stuff, child support. I did it all. I know about it all, and that's why I feel like God says, you know what, Jim? I'm going to put something new in you. It's a new song, and it's a hymn to me, and it's a praise to me, and I'm going to make you a freak. I'm going to make you a guy who's going to stand up in front of other people and say, Jesus is the only hope you'll ever have, and believe it with all my heart. Everywhere else, all the other questions, they're all lies. It's not true. He is our only hope. And so that's the gospel. God broke through to my heart and he put the gospel in there. And like I was telling the kids, I'm supposed to be pouring it into the lives of other people. Yes? So that's what happened. We get in the church. God, I met my loving wife, Jill. We got baptized together. Somebody says, you should start working with teens because you were a jerk when you were a teen. I'm like, yeah, that's true. I should. And so I started working with teens, and we moved around a little bit. I went to officer training school. I got commissioned, thanks to God. That's amazing, right? Because I certainly wasn't a college track guy. And then I went on from there. But I get into the church working with young people, and I get here in Dayton, Ohio. It's just like back in Maryland at the Pentagon. The kids are wasting their lives just like me. I'm looking around, and I say, these kids are worse than I was, and they're in the church. And not all of them, but a bunch of them. I'm like, man, we got to get the gospel into their lives. They need to know the truth. The truth is a lot of them are wasting their lives, and some of them are just not schooled in the Word, even though they were going to church. It's their families weren't what they appeared to be. And they're believing the same myths and the same lies that I believed, even though they're sitting in the church. Now, God knows this is true. Some of those teenagers, they taught me stuff because they knew the Word and they knew God better than I did. But a vast majority of them did not, and that's just the truth. Anyway, God moved in my heart. I believe, I know the moment that it happened, the second even that it happened, he said, you got to get out of the church and you got to reach young people with the gospel because they're not going to come to church. People like you are never going to come to church, Jim. It has to be some kind of a miracle, like the one for me in the carpool. God has to move into your life in some non-standard way generally. Do you believe that's true? I do. And so I started a little thing called The Cellar, and it kind of grew and grew and grew. It got stupid after a while. So many kids were coming and young people were coming. We were baptizing people like crazy. At one point in the first year, we started The Cellar Teen Center, if you will, outside the church. I baptized, I believe it was 94 teenagers in a church. And the church was like, what in the world is going on? Because they might baptize 2 or 3 or 5 in a year. Believe it or not, led to my ordination as an evangelist. And then I started another place called the Attic Teen Center. I was involved in another thing up in Tip City, Ginghamsburg, called the Avenue. Maybe you've heard of it. Ways to reach out with the gospel of Jesus Christ, because he put it in here, but he doesn't want it to stay here, does he? No, if you have been saved, if you once were lost and now you're found, you can't shut up. You can't. How could you shut up? If it's not true, then shut up. If it's true, you can't shut up. He said the rocks would cry it out. Is that right? The rocks would cry out? So anyway, you get into the lives of these young people and you find out that the home lives are not great, even though sometimes they're in big houses with lots of money. You find out the grandparents' lives aren't great. A lot of them are going to church, but they're living myths and believing myths, and they believe in fake news, you know? I'm not talking about political news. I'm talking about the fake news that's put on by Satan that says, oh, all roads lead, you know, to God in the end. It's not true. They're fabrications. So anyway, so what is a Christ follower to do when you find yourself kind of where I was, or maybe kind of where you're at now? What is a Christ follower to do? The vast majority of Christ followers, or if you will, just people who say they're Christians, say, the hell with them. We don't want those kind of people around us. And like back when I was working with young people, we don't want our children hanging around with those kind of children. What kind of children is that? You know the ones. You mean the human beings who probably haven't been told the truth, who need the love of God. Listen, don't get me wrong. I've got lots of kids, and I don't want them hanging around the wrong people. And I understand the truth of 1 Corinthians, where it says if you do that, you'll be misled. You can be led down the wrong path. But we still have to get it into their lives somehow. Yes? Yes, we do, or else we're not good stewards. We can practice isolationism, get in a holy huddle. And that's what most churches do. They just become their little family and they never reach out. Well, listen, what Jesus said is very simple. He said in the first two letters of the Great Commission, G-O. Anybody can read? What's that say? Go ye into all the world, baptizing in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them everything I have taught you, and surely I am with you to the very end of the age. Is that the Great Commission? And so the first two letters are what? Go. Go. What don't we understand? When I preach about Reach, Teach, and Send, our mission statement here, I'll always say this. What don't you understand about go? It's not about sit. It's about getting up and taking stuff on. And so what I'm trying to say today as I wrap up the stewardship sermon is this. We have to be good stewards of the gospel of Jesus Christ. We are, if you will, in my analogy to the kids, recipients of the water, the living water that's been put into us, and we are simply vessels, right? Jars of clay. But we can't just sit here and go, oh, I'm a jar of clay, yay. Because I don't believe that it's possible to have the Holy Spirit in you, to have living water in you, and not share it. I don't believe it's possible. Now, you can argue with me, and I'll get my Bible, and I'll argue with you. I'm just telling you, when he's in there, he wants to come out. Not to leave you, but to share. I believe there's no other way. And so if you don't feel that today, you might really want to pay attention to my next series, Knowing Jesus, because it's super important. Anyway, today as I wrap up this long lead-in, I got a couple things that I think we need to make sure that we do with the gospel. Number one, we need to keep it pure. It has to be pure, just like living water. What we also have to do is we have to share it. Obviously, I'm saying that we have to share it. To hold it in, you know, doesn't make any sense. One time when I was a kid, my mom gave me like three pieces of candy, gave my little sister three pieces of candy, and I ate mine like right away, and my sister saved hers. And, you know, it was getting all yucky and nasty, but like 2 hours later, my mom's like, you didn't eat the candy? I'm like, she's like, no, I'm saving it. She's like, well, then split it up and share it with your brother. And even I thought that wasn't fair. I thought it wasn't fair. You know, I'm like, why would she saved hers? You know, I ate mine. Why would she have to give some? I don't know why, but I'm telling you, when I was writing this down, I thought I should probably share that because for some reason, my mom wanted her to share it. For some reason, which is the hearts and souls of men and women, boys and girls, God wants you to share it. He doesn't want you to hang on to it. And so that's what we have to do. Number one, keep it pure. Keep it pure. Here is what Satan likes to do. He likes to just defile it. Some way, shape, or form, he likes to defile the gospel to make sure that it's not pure anymore. And so here's some of the myths, if you will, kind of that are thrown our way. Number one, I call it the colossal scale. The colossal scale. God has nothing to do with colossal scales. He is just and that's it. But the world, if you will, like to think that there's a scale. And so these people say something. Here's kind of what they say. If you're talking to somebody, you'll hear something like this. Hey, I'm not a bad person. Who's ever heard that before? Or maybe you said it. Well, my good God-fearing grandmother, you know, she's not a Christian, but she's a good person. Okay, it is a lie. There is no colossal scale. There is not one of those. Here's what people say. They'll say, well, I've done a lot of good in my life. I'm not as bad as those other people. And so what they think is, they think that there's some scale where there's good deeds on one side and there's bad stuff you shouldn't have done on the other side. And all you got to do is just tip that thing, you know, just a little bit to the good side. And oh, God's got you. You're good to go. That is not true. There is no scale. Without a miracle of God, every single person who ever breathes a breath is going to hell, and that's a fact. I know that's hard. I know it's not something I want to say from the pulpit. It's not something I want to beat into people's lives, but I'm telling you, if you don't start with the purity of the gospel, you can't get to the end. Romans 3:23, for who has sinned? All have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. We are all sinners, and that's where we all have to start. Here's another myth, and I was definitely one who bought this one. The myth is a loving God would not send people to hell. I remember talking to my mother, and I know God loves her, and I love her too, but for a long period of her life, she was far, far, far from the church. And so I was far from the church kind of as a result. Maybe it's my own evilness. I don't know. But I remember calling her one time, and she was hearing some of the stuff in my life when I was in the military. And she said, Jimmy, you know, God doesn't like any of this. So maybe she was coming back in the right direction. And I said, well, it doesn't really matter because God would never send anyone to hell. And she said, well, he made you. He'll do whatever he wants with you. I didn't know that at the time, but she was kind of quoting the Bible. It's kind of true. He makes all the pots of clay, and some of them for the fire, some of them for noble purposes, some for ignoble purposes. I'm not getting into that today. I just want to say, the people that have this myth, they'll say, I just don't want to believe that a good God, a loving God, would do that. I just don't want to believe it. Well, I don't want to believe lots of things that are true. Like when the cop pulls up behind me with the blue lights. I cannot believe I'm getting a ticket. Yeah, you're getting a ticket. It doesn't matter if you don't believe it. Imagine you have a child who just won't obey. Imagine you say, and I ripped this off from another pastor, a good friend of mine, but he was talking one day, he was reading a book, he was studying, and one of his kids is jumping from one chair to another chair, just about as far as a kid could jump, right? Whoop, it has to be a boy doing that, right? And so the kid's jumping, he's like, stop it or you're going to get hurt, right? You're going to get hurt. So he's going back to reading pretty soon, poop, jump, poop, jump, poop, jump. And finally says, I'm telling you right now, you better stop it or you're going to get hurt. Goes back to reading pretty soon, kid's jumping, he says, all right, I'll just let him get hurt. I'll just let him get hurt. And so guess what happens? 2 seconds later, bam, kid's flat on the floor crying. And so he picks up his child and he says, I love this child with all of my heart, but right now I want to kill him. Right? God's love and God's wrath can and do coexist. God is love, but God is also justice. God has love for us and grace and mercy, but he also has wrath. And you're either under wrath or you're under grace. And there's no options. They coexist in God. And so what the deal is this. 2 Peter 2, I'm going to read 4 and 9. For if God did not spare angels when they sinned, but sent them to hell, then the Lord knows how to rescue godly men from trials and to hold the unrighteous for the day of judgment while continuing their punishment. I know that we don't like that, but I think we all kind of understand it. And it is the purity of the gospel. When we saw planes flying into buildings on 9/11, was there anybody who didn't say, justice needs to be served? I think we all understand love, and we all understand justice, because we're made in God's image. Here's another myth that you'll hear, and I certainly listen to this one. There are many ways to heaven. There are many ways to heaven. People who believe that will say things like this. There's one God, but he's called by many names. Who are you to say, you know, the Hindus or the Muslims or whoever else, who are you to say, you know, that they're not God? And just last week, I was listening to some dumb show, and somebody sent me a clip, and I was like, all right, let me go ahead and watch this thing. And it was Joel Osteen. I'm not picking on him today, although I have in the past. but who is he? You know, he's like, I'm sure I'm really bothering him. So Oprah said this. She said, is Jesus the only way? Do you believe Jesus is the only way? And he said, quote, and I watched it over and over and over so I could get it right. He said, Jesus is the only way, but there are many ways to Jesus. I'm like, do I agree with that or do I disagree with that? Now, I'm not talking about does Jim agree or disagree. I'm like, does the scriptures agree or disagree? I'm like, all right, I'm going to be the devil's advocate. Okay, I agree with him. Because you can go through a carpool at the Pentagon, or you can go through, you know, something else, and there's lots of ways. But I think the inference is that you can go through a Hindu and get to Jesus in the end. Or you can go through Islam and get to, and those are not true. They're bastardizations of the gospel. They're not pure gospel. And here's the truth in the pure gospel, John 14:6. I am the way, and I am the truth, and I am the life. And a lot of us have heard that, but have we heard the last part? No one comes to the Father except through me. Those are the words of Jesus. Those are the words of the Messiah, Christ, the Lamb of God, the one who was slain from the beginning of the world, the only hope we've ever had. Those are his words. I am the way, I am the truth, and I am the life. And no one comes to the Father except through me. And so what I would hope Joel Osteen would say, and what I would say to you is today, there's only one way. There's only one truth. There's only one life that we can hope in. There's only one name that's higher than any other name, and it is the name of who? Jesus, Yeshua, Christ. There cannot be more than one truth. There's either truth, and everything else is not truth. But Satan loves it. He loves it. He has all kinds of even Christian denominations that'll say, oh, you know, just pray. Don't worry about all that other stuff. It'll work its way out in the end. It will. Unfortunately, it's not good. If God is a loving God, why would he kill his son if there was any other way? There is no other way. There could be no other way, and that's the point. We could never be perfect. And so a perfect sacrifice had to be slain, and that's the way it works out. You can read the Old Testament, you can say, I don't like it, but I'm telling you, you can work your way through, and you can see the picture of what was coming from the first page of the Bible all the way through the end. There is no other way. I think this is predominantly, though, one of the ones that I think affects the church in the United States more. I've seen it with my own eyes, and it's this myth that time in church equals acceptance by God. Time in church equals acceptance by God. So this happened some years ago when I was first starting that first little teen center, and we got thrown out of the first building by the city, so we moved into the church parking lot. It was kind of bad, you know, because nobody wants to come to church parking lot. But anyway, there was this kid in the church. He was a youth group kid, and I kind of worked with his younger brother, not with him, because he'd kind of grown out of the youth group. Anyway, somebody comes to me one time and said, did you see that bumper sticker? People who know me for a while know this is one of the stories just kind of gets me. Did you see that bumper sticker on what's-his-name's car? I'm like, no, what? And they're like, man, it's horrible. It's bad. It's really bad. I'm like, oh, what do I care about that? And they're like, it's sitting in the church parking lot. I'm like, oh, okay. So I wander over there. So I read this bumper sticker, so I will not tell you what it was because it was the foulest thing I've ever read. In the church parking lot, driven by a kid who grew up in the church, whose grandparents were the church, whose parents were the church. And I got really righteously angry. I did. And so I just kind of got it in my craw. And I knew he was in the building somewhere because his car's out there. It was actually a pickup truck. Eventually, he wanders his way down, and I see him. I said, hey, come here for a minute. Yeah, what? I said, I saw your bumper sticker. Yeah, so what? I'm just telling you, you need to take that off your car, or you need to never bring your car back to the church parking lot or something, because those two things don't go together. He's like, it's none of your business, really. I said, well, it is my business. And he said, well, let me tell you something. You just came here, Air Force guy. You've only been here a couple years. Me and my family have been in this church for 25 years. You see the truth right there? He thinks the years of membership in the church gets him something better than maybe I would get with God. And so what I said is this. You can either take it off, you can never bring your truck here again, or I can bash your window in. Well, I'll sue you. Sue away. I don't care. I mean, I know maybe I shouldn't say it, but I'm not taking it back. And he left peeling out, screaming, rubber, freaking out, you know. And he came back 2 hours later crying and gave his life to Christ. It's a true story. It's a true story. But he thought that he got something by being a member of the church. And that's what I told him to his face. You ain't getting nothing because you're a member of this church. They'll say things like this. I go to church every Sunday. When I was a kid, my parents would say, we went to church. My parents drug us on Monday. No, it wasn't Monday. Sunday morning, Sunday night, and Wednesday. Especially if you're a Baptist, right? You had to go on Wednesday. Or else, if the church doors were open, you had to be there, right? And they'll say things like this. Well, I go to Bible study, or I give money, or I tithe, or, you know, the colossal scale thing again. Or it's the same old lie. It means like, okay, so because you did something, you went somewhere, God owes you something? God owes you something now? That's not true. That's not pure. Here's the truth. Ephesians 2, 8 through 9. For it is by grace that you have been saved through faith. And this is not from yourselves, it is a gift of God, not by works of man, so that what? No one can boast. I can't stand up here and say, and there I was, pretty awesome, and like God, you owe me the gospel, and he like brought it over and gave it to me on a platter. That's ridiculous. It's absolutely ridiculous. But what's unfortunate is that a lot of people who grow up in the church, have a lot of religion, will never get there. See, I got there because I was horrible. Yeah. When I heard the truth, I was like, I need that right now. I need that right now. And I started thinking back to all the times when I was this close to dead, stupid driving, wrecking cars, and being ridiculous. I mean, any one of those moments could have been my last. What would I have had? I need grace right now. Unmerited favor from you, God. I need it in a big old lump. And when you get that, then you start saying things like, God is holy. God is holy, and God is righteous, and God is love, and he could have gave me justice, but instead he gave me grace, and I needed it. And thank you, God. And then you start living your life in a different way. The truth is that these myths are not really myths at all. They're lies. They're lies, and they're satanic lies. See, what Satan wants to do is, he wants to do like I did with the kids. He wants to give a wrong roadmap and say, no, this is the right one. You can get to there from here using this map, some made-up map. And you know it's not the right map because along the way you kind of get the hints. Well, this doesn't seem to be working well. You know, but I'm living my life and I'm having fun. See, what Satan wants to do is this. He wants to give you tons of religion. Or no religion. It doesn't matter. It's all the same to him as long as the key ingredient is missing. If there's no Jesus, Son of God, crucified, rose again on the third day, your only hope, then you have nothing. You can have church 24/7, or you can have no church at all. You get the exact same place because you have no key ingredient. And that's what Satan wants us to believe, that it's all okay without Jesus. Well, the results of following myths, or what do you want to call them, lies, will always get you to the wrong destination. Matthew 7, 23 and 22 and 23. This is the verse I was quoting earlier. Many will say to me on that day, Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name, and your name drive out demons and perform many miracles? Then I will tell them plainly, I never knew you. Away from me, you evildoers. You were not a good steward. You had all kinds of things that I expected a return on. You gave me none of them. What you gave me instead was what you got from your mama and your daddy, original sin, and you continued through your life with it, and you never had somebody else pay for it, and so now you will pay for it. I begged you to believe. I begged you to drop your pride, but you wouldn't do it. You were too darn busy doing you to think about me. Why didn't we know him? The saddest part is this. He says he stands at the door and he knocks, but we just never opened it. God screams, "Love me." He screams it from the stars. He screams it from the faces of your children. He screams it from truth when you know it and it tickles your ears and you're like, wait a minute, that's true. But Satan is also screaming lies and whispering lies. We just listened to the wrong one. Revelation 3:20, it's crystal clear. Here I am, Jesus said. I stand at the door and I knock. If anyone hears my voice and does what? Opens the door. I will come in and eat with him and he with me. Now, I've lived in the Middle East. I'm telling you what that means is we're going to sup together. That's the King James Version. We're going to eat. It's an event. It's like 21 courses. It goes on for hours and there's a cigarette between every course. Well, that's in the Middle East, not here. And probably not in heaven. But you get the point. It's like I'm going to live with you and you're going to live with me. We're going to hang out. We're going to be buddies. But first, you have to open the door and then I will come in. But here's what we generally do. Number one, we don't answer the door. Number two, we never stop fighting or arguing or working our angles with other people or with God. We just got to let him in. Stop fighting him. Open the door. Believe me, the wave will come over you and you'll see your sin. And you'll know the truth and you'll know what's right. Or else what we do is what most people try to do. I would say this is number three for me. We try to meet him on our own terms. We're going to meet God on our terms. That would be like I was like the world's greatest power, you know, which is probably China or Russia. and you beat up an enemy, you know, in a war you didn't want to go to it or whatever. But in the end, so you beat up all their people, and then you say, "All right, here's our terms. Come to here and do what we say." And you're like, "No, you come over here." Well, the war is still on, right? The war is still on, but that's what we try to do. We try to meet him on our terms. 2 Corinthians 7:10. Godly sorrow brings repentance that leads to salvation and leaves no regret. But worldly sorrow brings death. What a lot of times we do is we say, "Well, I feel bad about that." But not bad enough to say, "God, I need help." It's a different kind of sadness. It's a different kind of repentance. It's not the kind we need. And that's a key word for us today as I kind of like wind up. Repentance is the only way. It's a turning. It's an understanding that God is right and we're wrong and we change direction and we go the other way and we meet him on his terms. Your terms, God, that's all I care about anymore, not my terms. One of my favorite books, if you've never read it, pick up a copy. There's don't get the big one that's like thousands of pages. Get the ones like a couple hundred. It's a very quick read. It's called The Pilgrim's Progress. It's just an allegory, but it's really pretty cool. But in it, there's a guy, I think his name is Seeker or something like that, but eventually he becomes Christian. And everybody who he meets in the story, you know, has a name that kind of refers to kind of who they are. And anyway, at some point, there's this guy in the book who is, he's done a horrible thing and he's standing before a judge. Here's a quote out of the book. The judge says, "They're simply like the felon who stands before the judge. He shakes and trembles and seems to repent most seriously, but the bottom of it all is the fear of the hangman's rope, not that he has any loathing for the crime." So let me read again, make sure you catch both points. They're simply like the felon, so somebody who's done something horrible, right? Who stands before the judge, he shakes and he trembles and he seems to repent most seriously. But the bottom of it all is the fear of the hangman's rope, not that he is a loathing for his crime. See, we stand before God and say, "Oh, I don't want to like say it, but I do fear God at some level." But do you realize that you deserve what he's going to give you. See, we don't think we're that bad. We are that bad. We are that bad. And, you know, I'll tell you why. Do you realize who it is that you have offended? Do you realize who it is you've offended? You say, well, I offended my friend, or I offended this, when I said somebody was fat, or this, or whatever, and I offended that. No. You offended the gospel. You offended God because you're less than all of that which you were prepared for. Remember the very beginning I said we have all fallen short of the glory of God? We were not intended for that. You realize that these fearful thoughts of death kind of come from God? He's like, listen, pay attention. This is me. I have terms for you. And you need to take those terms. You need to listen. So anyway, let me transition to his terms quickly. Luke 14:33. Any of you who does not give up everything he has cannot be my disciple. Yeah, there's really nothing there except his terms. You got to give up. You got to give his terms. Luke 14:26. If anyone comes to me and does not hate his father, his mother, his wife and his children, his brothers and his sisters, yes, even his own life, he cannot be my disciple. Matthew 16:24. Then Jesus said to his disciples, if anyone will come after me, he must deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me. And so his terms are pretty simple. Give up everything, drop everything, and walk over to me, and I'll tell you everything, and I'll retrain you from the very beginning. All the religion you heard about, all the myths you've been living, they're not true. That's the pure gospel. It's not my will, God, but your will, God. That's the way it has to be. That's the way we have to say it. But the problem is, friends, we kind of like what Satan says. He says, have fun. You can worry about that stuff later. He'll say, it's not true. You're a good person. Remember the scale? Yeah, you're doing pretty good. It's okay. Those are not true. Makes us into control freaks. We'll just control it. No. Satan was a control freak. In fact, that's what got him thrown out of heaven. I don't know if you've ever read this before, but I'm going to read it to you today. This is why Satan was tossed from heaven. Isaiah 14, 12 and 15. Oh, how you have fallen from heaven, O morning star, son of the dawn. This is a reference to Satan, Lucifer. You have been cast down to the earth, you who once laid low the nations. You said in your heart, I will ascend to heaven. I will ascend to heaven. I will raise my throne above the stars of God. I will sit enthroned on the Mount of Assembly, on the utmost heights of the sacred mountain. I will ascend above the tops of the clouds. I will make myself like the Most High. But you, Lucifer, are brought down to the grave, to the pits, or the depths of the pit. You see what Satan does? He says, I will put my throne up above God. I will do this. I will be worshipped. I will make the decisions. I will decide what the terms are. And God, you can be pushed down and you can do it the way I want to do it. So when Satan says, I will, I will, I will, I will, God simply looks back and says, I am. I am. That's all he said to Moses, and that's exactly what he said to Satan, and that's what he will say to us. And so we got to be good stewards of the gospel by keeping it pure. And friends, I believe that is the pure gospel, as clear as it is. And then I know I'm running long, but I got to give you the second part, which I'm already beating up already. We got to share it. First, we need to live it. There's no doubt about that, because if we're not living it, when we try to share it, everybody's going to be like, shut up. Shut up. Here's a quote I dug up. What you do speaks so loudly that I cannot hear what you... Ralph Waldo Emerson. We have to live in life in such a way. I'm not saying we got to be perfect. We can confess all our sins just like I confess a bunch to you today. But I'm not saying, look at me, I'm awesome. I'm saying just the opposite. Look at him. He's awesome. And I'm struggling, and I need help, and so do you. And the scripture says not only that, we're ambassadors. We're ambassadors. So what does that mean? We don't do our own bidding. We don't set our own terms. We do His bidding, and I give you His terms. And so when somebody says, hey, do my wedding, I'm like, okay, give me this scenario. And I say, I can't do it. Well, why? Because those are His terms, not my terms, right? And it's the same with the gospel, 2 Corinthians 5:20. So we are Christ's ambassadors. God is making His appeal through us. We speak for Christ when we plead, come back to God. Come back to God. Anyway, friends, as we go today, as we close, as we pray, as we sing, whatever, I want you to make sure this is true. Have you ever just dropped your hands, dropped your pride, dropped all the stuff that's standing between you and Christ and say, I need you on your terms, not on my terms. I am a sinner. I've been a sinner since my mother gave birth to me and probably before. Everything that comes out of my mouth, wow, I know you've heard it and I'm sure you didn't like most of it. The stuff that's in my heart, I know you don't like that either because there's a lot of gory, horrible stuff in there. If I put my mind to it, God, you know I could do more evil than anyone has ever done. Help me with that. I need your help. And you just have to say that. And then you say, God, send the truth on me, break the lies out of me, put the light in me, make the darkness flee, and I'm yours. Know me. Know me. And let me know you. As the band comes, I've given you something today, hopefully will help you. You have to download the app. So Harvest Dayton. I don't get anything when you download the app. I only beat the drum because I think it helps you. Sure, you can give an offering on there, but that's just because a lot of young people don't really carry money anymore. They do the debit card thing, so that's where people give their offerings. That's fine. The reason I want you to download the app is because I give you the whole sermon, all of the scriptures, and the fill in the blanks so you can take it with you. And so you just put your email in, and it stays on our server, and anytime you want, you can just say, oh, where's that sermon? You can look it up. Okay, but today I've given you something more. I've given you a few verses at the very end that have nothing to do with the sermon, and it's not on the screen. And it's a simple thing called the Roman road. It's just a few verses out of Romans that are the gospel of Jesus Christ. I've given you a few of them today, and there's some other ones, but it starts with Romans 6:23, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. And the reason why I'm giving it to you is because I want you to take it. And there's probably somebody in your life who you know is this close, but they need to know the truth, not the lies that the world has been shoving at them. They need to help cut through the evolutionary trash they were taught in school or maybe some other religion stuff that they were given. They need help. And so you have God's word in you, and now you have God's word in the app, and you can write them down in your Bible. In fact, I brought this Bible, and anybody who's known me 10 or 15 years or more knows that I have the Roman road written down on the second page of this Bible. I wrote it down years ago, put it on a thing and put it right here. Now I know it in my head, I don't need to. But I wrote it down because I said, man, if this is true and it's changing my life, I gotta make sure I got it so I can share it with other people. And I put all kinds of other verses. If you want to look at this sometime, you can. All the verses that I ever thought were awesome for leading somebody to Christ, they're all in there. And then I revised it and I made it even better and I did it on the third page. What's my point? We have to be good stewards of this. And to be a good steward of the gospel, of course, is to keep it pure, right? To live it. But we also have to share it. We have to share it. Pray with me. Father, thank you for your word, because we know it's truth. Thank you for your Holy Spirit that leads us to your truth. Father, I pray for all those who hear my voice today. Lord, if I've spoken your word, I pray it will haunt every person who doesn't believe until they drop the pride and grab the truth. And Father, I pray for every person who hears my voice, who does believe, that they'll be prompted. Whatever you want to prompt them, Lord, but certainly to share your truth. Father, we love you. Help us to love you more. And we pray it in the name of your Son, Jesus.